plantation in Bladensburg, and I had to flee my own home country of Belgium a long time ago when I was just a girl, because our homes and our lives there were being threatened by Napoleon. So my family, we ran for our lives, sailed all the way across the ocean to America to find peace. And now we're being invaded right here in Maryland, because America is at war with her former mother country, England. Before the war with America, in England you have been fighting France, this lunatic Napoleon who's trying to take over the world. You've been fighting France for many years. Life on an English ship at this time is very hard. Boys, you might be stuck on this ship for months or years. The pay is not very high, the food is not very good because of this long war with France. And punishment is very severe. Many of you want to run away. So many English sailors desert. Now this is a crime. You leave your ships to find work on American ships, but that's against the law. So the British start stopping and searching American ships to try to take back their sailors. But when I look at you, how on earth can I tell if you're American or English? And don't tell me accent, but many of your families came from England. You don't come over and start talking American, you still sound British. So they say, oops, we made a mistake. I'm taking you and you and you. And you say, but I'm American. Americans, are you going to put up with that?
No!
But of course, at this point, England has the greatest army and navy in the world. And to them, America, you're just that new little baby country. You don't even know what you're doing. We have a new president, I think much better. And his name? James Madison. Now, President Madison does not want to go to war against England at first. You know, that would be ridiculous. America doesn't even have a navy. They have the biggest navy in the world. And so this is what you say, President Madison. Say,
can't we all just get along?
And the answer is no, and that's right. People laughed at him because the British do not care what he says. They keep stopping and stealing our supplies and our men. So, alas, in June of 1812, the war hawks in Congress declare war on Great Britain. And then they blame it on you, and they call it Mr. Madison's War. Isn't that just like Congress, huh? This is Admiral Sir James Colborne. I picked him because he's wearing red. What did we call British soldiers in the Revolutionary War? Red coats, lobster backs. So there he is. He's the best England's got, and unfortunately, he's coming to invade Maryland. In fact, in Maryland, we are so terrified of him that when children misbehave, parents will say, oh, you better do what I say. You better be good, or Colborne will get you. Admiral Colborne, I want you to take a look at your troops. Inspect your army. How do they look? Go ahead, look them over. How do they look? They do. This is the finest army in the world. You're veterans. You're experienced. That's right. Very well. President Madison, how do the American troops look? Right, exactly. So, you march right up to the Capitol and you say,
burn it.
Oh no, he's burning our Capitol. He goes to the brand new Library of Congress and all those beautiful books and you say,
burn it.
Oh. And then he marches up to the President's Palace. That's what they call it. It's really only a two-story little wooden house. But you walk right into President Madison's dining room. And on the table is supper that Dolly has made for him. So what are you going to do?
Burn it.
Oh, no, you're not. Right. He's going to put his feet up on the President's table and eat his supper and then burn the house down. So the British have captured and burned Washington, but the President escaped. Baltimore is not unprotected. It has Fort McHenry. But the President had said, look, we cannot win. They're too strong. He told the fort's commander to surrender. And that commander said, I'm going to fight. By the way, people of Baltimore, those Washington cowards ran away when the enemy came. Are you going to run away too?
No!
The people of Baltimore said, we're going to fight for our city. You start digging ditches, building bulwarks, men, women, children, slaves. Everybody in Baltimore is pitching in together. You're not going to run away like the people in Washington. You're going to fight for your town. Now, flying over Fort McHenry is a giant battle flag. big flag. They're sewing by hand, by candlelight, bleeding fingers, trying to get it done. We're now up to the bombing of Fort McHenry, 13 September, 1814. The British start bombing with everything they have, rockets, shells. The bombing goes on for 25 solid hours. It's terrifying. And then all of a sudden, the next morning, it stopped. Francis, you're straining your eyes. You're hoping that maybe once the smoke settles, you might be able to see which flag is flying over Fort McHenry. Because if it's their flag, that's the end. Probably for Baltimore and America's freedom. So, it's just at sunrise, and just as it starts to get daylight, and just as the smoke from the shooting starts to settle. He's so excited and amazed that, well, you're a poet. You start writing a poem. And it starts out, "Oh say, can you see by the dawn's early light?" The poem's called The Defense of Fort McHenry. And you keep writing verse after verse after verse. So people love the poem and they say, "Let's put it to music. We're going to take one of your drinking songs, an English drinking song, and we're going to sing about how we beat you. Ha ha." Of the United States, and you didn't even know it would have any such power, right? Or what?
Oh, say.